way that CFPB does get information through very informal means. So how we're gonna go, we're gonna do generally, talk about the scope and some general definitions, get us all on the same page. I'm gonna go into the loan estimate first. That's what we're, will replace the good faith estimate. So it's the first major disclosure that we'll talk about. There's two different sections of Reg Z. This is Truth in Lending Act now that we're talking about. These parts of RESPA have been moved into just one regulation, the general rules and completing the form. Once we get through that, it's all downhill from there. The closing disclosure looks very, very similar. That was the whole point. These forms were designed after a significant amount of testing with consumer groups around the country to say what is important to you on these disclosures that you've been given, the good faith estimate and these other six other sheets of paper that you've been given. What is important? And through studies and Know Before You Owe was the initiative, they've come up with these forms, and the intent is that they match at closing so that the closing looks very similar to what they've received early on. And so the closing disclosure pieces will be very quick, and then we'll go over the requirements, and if we have time, we'll do the discussion and kind of create in our head an implementation checklist that won't have 400 items, but maybe 5 or 10 big points that you can go back to your shops and talk about. Now, I've already talked about this. The rule is effective for applications received on or after August 1st, but it's a two-tier operations. You can't use old on new, and you can't use new on old, okay? We've talked about that, so you may have to have people back in your shop that are thinking old rules for a while. Everybody has somebody back in the banks that are not here that can just remember the old rules? If not, I mean, I call it blissfully ignorant. Some of you in the room may want to be blissfully ignorant over the new rules. You can keep them in mind, how do we used to do it? Tolerance is one area that we'll see gets confusing when we compare it new to old. What are we talking about? All closed-end consumer credit transactions secured by real property. That's the language the reg rule uses. That definition includes vacant land. They're clear about that. It includes construction-only loans, and it includes loans over 25 acres. What it also includes are loans secured by commercial property that have a consumer purpose. All we're talking about is real property. We're not talking about residential real property in the reg. That's a point where the consultants, you know, may want to asterisk that. It's clear to me this does include, it's not a common situation that you would lend money on commercial property for a consumer purpose, but it does occasionally happen. So it's not only residential under the reg. But it does not include HELOCs because they're open end. And it does not include mobile home only loans. Does anybody do those up here in this neck of the woods? Yeah. So you're gonna have that other system in place where you're gonna close on the old Fed box, all the other old disclosures that related to a mobile home loan. Keep those out of your mind when we're thinking of this rule. One point is, does anybody make loans to borrowers that are trustees of a trust? The trust has been prepared basically for estate planning purposes. I put my home in trust with me as trustee and me as beneficiary. That's for all intents and purposes, a consumer situation. The trust was created for consumer purposes. So this rule makes it clear, although there's always has been the exemption for business purpose loans, and it had been deemed that a loan to a trust or a corporation was deemed business purpose, this rule carves out trusts that were created for consumer purposes and says they are covered under this rule. If it's a consumer purpose transaction, a trust, a loan to a trust is a consumer purpose covered transaction. So I said there's no good faith. We also got rid of the early till, and we'll see several other disclosures. So we're really kind of commingling multiple disclosures into one form to deal with. Same thing on the closing side. No HUD settlement statement for these loans, no closing truth in lending disclosure. Application definition is slightly different under today's rules as what will happen in August 1st. Today we have this catch-all, any other information deemed necessary can prevent you from having to provide a good faith estimate. Under rules effective August 1st, once you have these six pieces of information, name, income, social security number or whatever number you need to pull a credit report, property address, an estimate of the property value and the mortgage loan amount, you have an application for purposes of having to deliver the early disclosure. Now, does anybody take applications online up here? Some do. You can sequentially collect this information so that it's later on in the process and even in your paper world to try and gather some things that are important for providing the disclosures, like what type of loan do you want? That's kind of important. Is it going to be an ARM? Is it going to be a fix, a balloon, a 10-year, 20-year, 30-year, whatever products you offer? Now, you may not offer all those products, and then it's a little bit easier. You're going to disclose based on what you offer. But when you have multiple product types, that's not something that you need to get in order to have met the requirement to give a disclosure. So things are going to change or could change. But on an online situation, you can sequentially ask for that information before the six items. And then the question had been answered if you don't press submit, they fill it out but save it for later. Or say it's a refi or an existing customer, where we have that information in our files, are we required to go get it to complete an application? The answer is no. They have to actually submit this to you as a new credit request before it's been deemed to be received. And this can be oral, can be a phone call. So it's like under today's standards. They give you this information by phone, you have it, it is now an application. Okay? Let's get past this first, because this is like an example, one of just a couple, where this reg is screwy. I put this early so we get it out of the way. When I use the term definition, the term business day, it has two different definitions depending on what context I'm using it. For the loan estimate, delivery and expiration or revision, the definition of business day only includes the days you're open to the public for carrying on substantially all of your business. So who here has branches or offices open on Saturdays? At those locations, do you have operations staff?
No.
Just the branch customer service type staff. That makes it easy. You obviously aren't open for substantially all of your banking purposes. So you would not count Saturdays as a business day for the loan estimate, delivery, redelivery, or expiration. For all other purposes, when I use the term business day, we have to count Saturdays. They are not excluded. Just like under today's world with the definition of rescission, Saturday counts as a business day. Now that helps us under rescission rules because that shortens their rescission period, but under these rules it doesn't help because it shortens our time frame for having to get these disclosures out or react. So when we think of business days and we hear seven, you gotta remember Saturdays are going to be included. So that shortens your business days, as does federal holidays, and I've listed them here. The first four are actually dates. If the holiday doesn't fall on that date, it doesn't count. It's not the day that that holiday may be celebrated, it's those enumerated dates. The other ones are the days that it's celebrated. Not sure why Washington's birthday got moved over there, but it's not supposed to be. So as far as the loan estimate, we receive the application, we have two tests that need to be met. We have to provide the loan estimate within 3 business days of receiving. Business days, again, the loan estimate, you do not count Saturdays, so we have some extended period of time. But the second test is that loan cannot close until they've had at least, it has to be delivered or placed in the mail at least 7 business days before consummation. So you got a similar test as today under NDIA standards. Let's just give an example. They received the application on Monday. They had to have mailed that LE, the loan estimate, by the third business day after application receipt. So that's Thursday. The earliest that loan can possibly close is the following Friday. That would be on the 7th business day following delivery. Or read backwards, 7 business days before consummation was when they delivered. You can read it either way. And I just make a note because later on we're going to talk about redisclosure of the loan estimate. That doesn't trigger an additional waiting period of the 7 days. Okay, it might trigger for APR purposes, but it does not trigger an additional 7 business days under this rule. Has anybody ever had a waiting period or a rescission period waived for bona fide financial emergency?
No.
It happens occasionally. Is anybody else warm? I'm a little warm. Can you turn it down, Jamie? Thanks. There is the potential to waive this waiting period if needed. Like the example the reg gives is for imminent foreclosure of the borrower's home. So we're not talking a common situation, but it could possibly happen. So all of these responsibilities are to the creditor. As I mentioned, it's the person who the note is payable to on its face. Even if at or after closing you're gonna assign it to a third party, your investor, they're not, for these purposes, the creditor. You are. Oh. I could have done that. I did not know.
Well, you can adjust it from your BDQ.
Thank you. Pick this up while you're there. No. All right. To who does the disclosure need to be provided? Just the primary applicant. If there's multiple, you can just give it to the primary applicant, assuming we're not in a rescission world. For rescission purposes, all the applicants that will be borrowers need to get a copy of that loan estimate. So if you're just talking a purchase transaction, only the primary applicant, the borrower, needs to have received that. And I do make a comment here when I talk about rescission. For the closing disclosure, rescission notice has to be given to anybody who has rescission rights. That can be a non-borrower. Remember that. If you've got a spouse who's not a borrower on the loan, if it's their homestead, they have a right to rescind that transaction. So they don't have to get the early disclosure here, the closing, the loan estimate, but they will have to get a copy of that closing disclosure. They're not a borrower, but they do have rescission rights. So the new loan estimate, let's take a look at it. You guys all have handouts? The forms handout? Starts on page 1. Page 2 and page 3, that's a complete example of the loan estimate. The CFPB put out a guide to forms, and they put out samples in the reg and separately. So I just picked up what I thought to be a representative that we could look at. So what we're going to learn is that these three pages replace 7 pages we're currently giving to a new loan applicant under today's standards. I do want to remind you about the special information book. This is for primary home purchases, not a refi, but you can give it out for refi. It's been revised. It's not called a special information booklet, it's called a toolkit, because it's actually very interactive. Has anybody read this yet? It takes about 8 minutes for a banker to read it. It's very easy, very simple. These are the conversations in here that you probably, as lenders or your lenders back at your banks, credit union, would have discussions with borrowers about. But here it's in black and white, easy to read, bullet point font, you know, tabular with images. My 9-year-old son walked past me and was reading it, you know, from the computer behind me, understood it, except he didn't know what the word pitfall meant. Okay. But it describes things like the cost of a home is not just the mortgage payment. You have to think about taxes, insurance, maintenance, upkeep. Put that in your budget. It talks about how a credit score can affect the interest rate you get paid or you have to pay, and how to work to improve your credit report, maybe months before you actually apply. Talks about the relationship with down payment and private mortgage insurance. So many consumers do not understand private mortgage insurance. They think based on the surveys and the groups, studies, they think it's just the way banks make extra money. They just add it in to make extra money. They don't realize that it's related to their amount of their down payment. If they wait a little while and save, they could avoid that cost. The relationship of points to closing costs and the ability to pay them down by paying points up front. The requirement or suggestion to shop for a lender, which we know even under the new rules, a lot of consumers do not shop. They do not comparison shop lender to lender. This also has new disclosures of flood insurance under the Dodd-Frank Act, the fact that there's private flood insurance that's now allowed. And it does describe, as we'll talk about, the title insurance for owner's title. It's a wonky calculation that we're gonna have to think about and look to. It mentions that in here. So this is a really good book. That's what you have to give in addition to the three-page loan estimate. As well as if you're doing ARM loans, does anybody here do ARM loans? You've got the consumer's handbook and your armed program disclosures. Although we'll see a lot of disclosures on these forms related to arms, they do not replace the need to give out those documents. Also, the homeownership counseling notice, the 10 agencies in that consumer zip code, you'll still have to give that out. The initial escrow statement, and if you do refer business to an affiliated business provider, you still have to provide that separate disclosure under RESPA. So those are things just to remind you what don't go away. Okay, the written list of providers. This is in your forms handout on page 17. Here's a concept that changes dramatically under the new rules, the concept of shopping. Under the current rules, you can shop from our list. Under the new rules, you can shop from the world. And that's what the definition of shop means. If you wanted to say, for all purposes, when we talk about shopping, it means the consumer has the right to pick anybody they want within reasonable requirements. They do not have to pick from your list. This disclosure, though, is your starting point for them. For services that they can shop for, go anywhere, you have to provide a starting point, a vendor, a provider, their name and address, their contact information. You don't have to provide the cost on this page, but you can. So that's what this document is for. If you have any services that the consumer can shop for, you have to hand this out, or else you'll be penalized. Because one of the beautiful things about being able to shop for, we'll see the tolerances, they go into the world, as they are today, unlimited. Let's cut that. That vendor charges $1 million for a product that you disclose a rational fee for, you're not gonna be hit with that. If they pick somebody that is on your list that they were allowed to pick the world, you get another tolerance as well, 10%. We'll go through the tolerances later, but my point is you have to get this out if you have any vendors that a consumer can shop for. So who might that be? Who can a consumer shop for in your residential, in your loan world? Somebody that they're going to pay for at closing, but they can shop for. Title.
Survey.
Pest inspection. Termite.
Kristen, we actually have to, like, on the title, if we're showing this at the shop, or have to break it down on the service provider if you give an estimate.
Yes. See how they've got it there? You don't have to provide a service provider for each one of those, but you do have to break down the individual fees that they will be required to pay for. If you require them to pay for them. Not optional fees, but these are fees that you require them to pay for. Yep.
So the home inspection part come in this section because of some of the grant programs you require to have a home inspection for them to get the loan.
As long as they can pick whoever they want for a home inspector, you know, that's licensed and or not on your list, that they would count as being able to shop for. Is there a list somewhere that they have to pick from?
No, at this point, but just the home inspection and some programs required, so would it be included?
It would be included as a required service, and you would disclose a cost for it, but they can shop for who they want to provide that service. Okay, because at this point in the loan estimate, we're disclosing fees that the consumer is likely to pay based on prior knowledge of transactions of that type based on the county, or perhaps if we have it based on that contract, the purchase contract. So these are fees that they're likely to pay, even if they're not required by us. So you would look to what is typical for that type of transaction. Okay, and I circled at the top just describing, reminding you, you can select these providers or shop for your own providers. I'll just tell you that there is a model form of a list where they can't shop. You do not have to use that form, and I do not suggest that you use that form. There's no benefit to you in the whole world of ever providing that form. Somebody tell you otherwise, Kim? No. This is confusing. Why did he give them a model form that you really have no benefit in the end of the day to provide your list that you're going to be picking from or that they have to pick from? You're not getting a benefit from that. These are ones where they can go the whole world. You're just providing them a starting point. So there is a requirement before you provide the loan estimate, or before you have an application, let's put it that way. You can disclose fees, like a general marketing type fee. Here's what you would pay if you were to apply for with us, or on a pre-qual, or something where you don't have those six pieces of information where your customer is asking. You don't want to be bound to a loan estimate at that point, because you are bound once you provide it with the ability to have changes in situations which we'll talk about. So the point here is, does anybody do this today? Because you can have a fee sheet. You can under the new rules, but it has to have on the top this bolded sentence, and it can't look like this form at all. It can't be the same or similar. It cannot be misleading. And that rule actually is effective on August 1st, even if you haven't received an application. It makes sense, because at this point you haven't received the application if you're giving one of these out. So, also effective on August 1st, whether you've received an application or not, is you can't charge a fee until the customer, the applicant, has received the loan estimate and indicates an intent to proceed. You can charge a fee for credit report. Clarify that. Does anybody charge for appraisals prior to closing?
Yes.
Some of you do. You can't charge until you've given them the good faith and received their intent to proceed. Similar to today's rules, right? This is a little more important though. There's an actual record retention requirement in this rule now. You have to document that you've received that intent to proceed. It doesn't have to be on any particular form. Many of you have forms already. Your investors want to see them. And you can use that, and you can sign it and say, I swear that I received the good faith or loan estimate, and I intend to proceed. Then you can charge your fee for the appraisal, for ordering the appraisal. Another new thing clarified is you can't have, prior to that signing or documenting their intent to proceed, you can't take a post-dated check or a credit card information, right? I see that in files all the time. Credit card information and expiration and the security code that goes on the back. That's not good for multiple reasons. That violates PCI security standards on credit cards. But under this rule, you can't have that authorization until they've received their good faith and, or loan estimate and intent to proceed. Clarifies that. Now you can get that authorization for the credit report and use it again, the numbers, but you have to receive a new authorization to use those numbers after the intent. So it's not called a good faith estimate anymore, but there is inherently in it a good faith standard that the fees that you're disclosing have to be made in good faith based on the best information reasonably available. My acronym for that is BIRA. And that is inherent in everything you do, even when we'll find out there are tons of fees that you don't have to have a tolerance for. Like, for example, an off-the-list shop in the world provider. You still needed to have disclosed the fee for that in good faith based on best information reasonably provided, reasonably available. The question had come up, appraisers. Can we over-disclose? Can we over-disclose fees so that at the end of the day, we're sure we're not going to be out of tolerance or they're not going to have to pay more than we disclosed? No. If it's not based on the best information reasonably available, you're still not in good faith. There's no monetary penalty for that built into the rule, but it would be a violation. And it could be UDAP, you know, unfair and deceptive act of practice. And who knows what that is, but they can make it be part of it. Now, obviously, 3 days in, you're not going to know everything. You have the right and expectation to talk to third parties in your triangle to say what are your fees going to be, or even outside the triangle. It could be a giant, one of those spirograph games with people you're talking to try and figure out the fees. All right. Any questions so far? Let that marinate for a second. I want to check to see if there's anything I wanted to be sure I told you about. Joint applicants where you don't have the six pieces of information on them. You don't have an application. You do not have to issue a good faith or a loan estimate when you have the six pieces of information on one applicant. It is not received if you don't have that information on all applicants. As a broker, you can provide the good faith or the loan estimate. You can tell it's been over a week since I've spoken on this. But then you're bound to keeping a record of that for 5 years, the record retention, even if the loan does not close. So if you're acting as a broker, does anybody act as a broker where you're doing the application and processing, but your name is not gonna be on the note? Okay, so you've got potentially responsibilities under this. Have you talked to your investors? Do they want you to issue the loan estimate, or will they be doing that?
Well, it's pulled from their system.
It's pulled from their system based on information you put in, though. So you're providing it, essentially. They're going to be bound, as they are today, to your loan estimate, to your fees and such that you disclose there.
Kristen.
Yeah.
We have a scenario where we have a customer come in and we're looking at the loan being a sole joint investor. So we've done our loan estimate. Well, our closings, our recording fee on a mortgage for a loan sole joint investor is substantially higher than an in-house mortgage because it's a lot more pages.
Okay.
Okay, so we've disclosed, assuming that that was going to be the case.
Right.
Something has occurred, and that's not going to happen, and we have a genuine change circumstance, and we're re-disclosing. Should we lower that fee then? Because we know at that point in time, the mortgage is going to change significant number of
to pages. A lower number?
Yes.
Yes, you should.
Okay.
Now, do you have to issue, if that's the only change, will you have to issue a change circumstance?
Yeah. Well, we do, because we're going from a fixed to an arm, so we're changing
programs. Programs.
Yeah.
Yeah, but technically, unless you've hit those change circumstance, we'll talk about that and want to confuse it, but you don't have to issue a revised loan estimate unless one of those change circumstances occurs, then you have to. That's the next slide. One slide more. Just first, let's talk about the tolerance. I mentioned, I alluded to this fact, and we're familiar with this today. With regard to fees that have changed from what we've disclosed to what are charged at closing. So the general rule, assuming you made it early in FIRA, as long as the charge at closing doesn't exceed what was disclosed on the loan estimate, it was made in good faith. There are exceptions that are still made in good faith, a tolerance level, if you will, for these items. 10% tolerance is allowed for the aggregate of the recording fees, as Tammy had mentioned, and third-party charges from the list where you are allowed to shop. So it's a service, they could have picked anybody, pest inspection, but they picked your person on your list. Or they didn't pick and you picked somebody. So those are 10% aggregate. You add them all together. Any one could be significantly off. You may have even failed to disclose, or the opposite. You disclosed that they needed a pest inspection and they didn't. As long as when you add them all together in aggregate, those fees do not exceed more than 10% of what you disclosed on your loan estimate, you're fine. It's not a violation. That was still made in good faith.
Okay, so the pest inspection, it says it's optional to put another figure in there, so that's going to be part of that tolerance. So is it best to have an amount in there, or
it's when you say they say it's optional.
Well,
if you mean,
yeah, just on page 17 where it says it's optional to actually put that dollar amount in, you have to list all that you can shop for the survey or the test, but you don't have to put an amount there. That's part of the tolerance you're talking about.
No, let's clear this up. So page 17, when I say you don't have to put an estimate here, that's simply on a list. That is not the fee disclosure.
That's the list on the estimate itself you have to put.
The estimate itself,
okay.
If you know or expect that the consumer will have to pay for a pest inspection, then you put it on there as a disclosed fee. That's on page 2 of the handout.
Okay, so the list, you don't have to put the estimate, you do.
Yes.
Okay.
On the list, you don't have to disclose a dollar amount, but on the estimates, you do.
Okay.
And so on page 2, pest inspection is listed under services you can shop for. You can pick anybody you want in the whole wide world. And if that's the case, if they pick somebody that was on your list, so they picked Pestco, Jane Polk, then her fee can differ by what you've disclosed when you add up all of those services that they shop for and picked off of your list, or that they could have shopped for and you picked, 10%. Now, say you disclose pest inspection on the loan estimate. At the end of the day, she doesn't use it. The borrower doesn't need the pest inspection. You don't get to include the pest inspection in the list to compare what was closed, what was charged at closing. You only compare actually fees that were charged at closing to those fees that were disclosed on the loan estimate. Okay, so it's that's where it's the aggregate of. Things can flow in and out of that category. You don't count them if you don't, they don't count in the first comparison if they weren't charged at the end of the day. Make sense?
Yes, thank
you. Okay.
And if the third party, I mean, if the provider is not on your list, $0.
Yeah, that's down at the bottom. Zero tolerance are unaffiliated third parties, I'm sorry, variations permitted, unlimited, not zero tolerance. Charges for third party service providers shopped by the consumer. So these are people that were off the list. Unlimited variation is allowed. That $1 million example.
Assuming it's still frowned upon, that you need more than one name on the list.
Yeah, no more than one name on the list. You know more than one name on the list. Is my suggestion. I mean, you can
well,
have
I thought it was kind of frowned upon by the examiner, because that was always been talked about. Just put one and make me hopefully they'll get somebody else.
No, that's currently the rule. That is the rule here under August 1st. One, don't do more than one. Nobody's expecting you to do more than one. Look at the example. One for every, because you do want them to go off your list. They pick the one on here, you're into the 10% if they go off of it. But the point, to me, the greater question is, how do you prove that they actually are allowed to shop anybody if they do pick somebody that's on your list? And if 9 out of 9 loans we look at, they pick somebody on your list, my question would be, are they really allowed to pick somebody off your list or not? Are you coercing them?
No.
Never. Well, and I'm sure most of them fall into this pattern that they did not pick anyone. I don't care, you pick them for me. I don't want to have to go find a pest inspection company as well. Somebody you know, I trust you. I'm going to pick whoever you want. Then you still are at the 10% because you picked it. They did not go off your list.
What?
They did not select somebody on your list. Doesn't really matter. If they don't pick somebody that is completely off your list, you're 10% tolerance. Unless they're an affiliate, then we fall down into zero tolerance. Fees to creditor, your brokers, or your affiliates, or your lender credit if you do no-cost loans, or you offer to pay for the appraisal, if you're giving credit, those are zero tolerance from the loan estimate to the closing disclosure. They cannot change. Any dollar that changes, unless you have a reason to have a revised loan estimate, you are going to eat those costs. That's pretty much the same as today. Now, the one big difference on that is this bullet point 2, unaffiliated third party where they're not allowed to shop, where you have to pick that provider. What is the biggest example of that?
Appraisal
to me is the biggest difference because that they are not allowed to shop, so you are going to be bound by the cost of the appraisal. Now there are changes allowed, and we'll talk about it again.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah,
they go out and do an inspection and there's something that needs to be fixed and you got to send an appraiser back out.
Yep. And that's a changed circumstance, and that's different. But think about this. This is, to me, one of the greatest requirements of this rule is documenting through the course of the application the changed circumstance. So let's go to it. Let me just make sure. Other things that can change: prepaid interest, property insurance, amounts in escrow, customers picked, third parties that were picked off of the list, and anybody that you don't require. So pest inspection, if you don't require them, any of their charges can change by an unlimited amount. All right, so that's a big, I think that's a big win. But the unaffiliated third party not allowed to shop, zero tolerance, is a little bit of a lose. Transfer taxes is the same and lender credit is the same. So let's talk about the revisions, because these are big and these happen. And the CFPB did put out a timeline example, and in their timeline example, it happened no less than 5 times that the lender issued a revised LE. So we're expecting to see this, especially because you know, your timing is so strict on these and your tolerances are so narrow that you're going to want to issue a revised LE when you can and when it counts. When you can or when you have to. Number one, if you have a floating rate that gets locked, who issues rate locks here? Just a couple, most of the ones that are secondary. Portfolio lenders don't issue rate locks. So you would not be able to use this example. For those that actually get written rate locks, you can use this. When you get a lock, you must issue a new revised LE that will show a change, and we'll see it. Allowed for revisions requested by the consumer. So the consumer wants to change a loan amount or wants to add another party to it or changes the property. Those are changes requested by the consumer. You are allowed to provide a revised LE and are not bound by tolerances from your original LE. If the original LE is expired, we have 10 business days under the current rule that the LE is warranted to make be an off to stay effective. You can go longer if you want. You don't have to. But if it's expired at 10 days, you can issue a revised LE. And construction loans. Who does construction loans? Lots of y'all. It may be more than 60 days from the six items and the day that thing's going to close. So you have at least, you have the ability to disclose that you're going to provide a revised LE 60 days prior to the closing and be bound by that LE. This one is not binding. Okay, if change exceeds the tolerance. So this is a big test here. Remember we talked about the 0 and the 10% tolerance, especially the 10% aggregate. If a change happens that doesn't cause those fees to go outside of those tolerances, you are not supposed to issue a revised LE. I mean, the CFPB was clear that they wanted as few revision LEs as possible. The more revised LEs the consumers got, the more confused they got. So this is a mandate that you can issue it if you want, but it's not going to count for purposes of the tolerance comparison if you issued an LE before, under circumstance 5 or 6, if you issued it before you were mandated to. So for example, something happens in one of your fees. I think I'm going to take this right out of the reg so that I don't make stuff up. So title fees is an example in this case of a fee category that can increase more than 10% because the consumer picked from your list. Now they've got an unreleased lien discovered and the title company has to perform additional work to release the lien, but the additional costs are only adding up when you do your analysis to 5% increase in what was originally disclosed for those aggregate fees. So a change circumstance has occurred, but the sum of all costs has not increased more than 10%. You're not prohibited from issuing revised disclosures, but if you do, in that scenario, when the closing disclosure is actually delivered, the actual title fees originally disclosed are going to be the comparison, not the revised. Now, say 2 days later, you get a required pest inspection fee has increased. And so now when you add the 10% category of fees, it's increased 6%, say. Now you have an 11% increase. You must, or if you want to take advantage of that change circumstance, issue a revised LE showing the effect of both of those changes. So here's the kicker from a documentation standpoint. If I'm opening up that file, how am I going to know what the hell happened? How is anybody going to be able to know that the timing first happened with the title and the date and how it affected the fees? Second happened with the pest inspection and the date and what happened with the fees and how you reacted to that. You guys are going to need to be really good at communicating these changes. My first instinct was to say the LOS systems need to help you out with this. Almost like a conversation log like you have today to be able to say, talk to the client or talk to the title agent or talk to the pest inspector, talk to whoever. Was this a changed circumstance? If so, yes, and why? Did it affect fees? And let the system calculate that for you. See, best way, that's the best scenario for this to happen. The worst scenario is you guys get out a piece of paper and a pencil and you calculate all this out to figure it out. So that's why, in my opinion, the LOS systems are taking so long, and some systems are saying, we're not gonna do this. Are you kidding me? It's a new area for us. We're not gonna be in the business that long. So it doesn't have to be a huge, giant concern. I see everybody's faces went frowny-poo. You know, it's not too much different than what you have to do today as far as documenting what was the change circumstance. This is just an additional level. If it wasn't based on the expiration or a consumer change or floating rate, if something happens that affects the value of the security or the creditworthiness of the borrower after you've issued that LE, or an extraordinary event beyond their control, you just have to recalculate those fees that are subject to 10% and zero tolerance. Something changes beyond the tolerances, issue a revised LE. And star it and say, this is the one we're gonna use until the next starred one comes along. That's the one we're gonna use. So some examples of a change circumstance. Can take a break in a few minutes here. Okay, an extraordinary event beyond the control of the party. So I would use earthquake in the red, but we're more likely to have a hurricane, right? Or a flood or something that damages the property in the middle of this or results in some kind of additional cost. Unexpected events specific to the consumer or transaction. Here's the example the reg gives. The title insurer selected for the estimate goes out of business during underwriting. They decide, we don't want to do this kind of lending documentation anymore. We're getting out of the business if that happens. Or information that was relied on or became inaccurate or was changed. This is more likely to be the situation. This is five or six, really. I think you could argue it either way. If the consumer's income was told to you as $90,000, because that's one of the six factors, and remember, you can't require them to provide proof of any of those six factors at the time you're issuing the LA, and later they give you an income tax statement or an income tax form that says they actually earned $40,000, that's significant, and it changes perhaps the loan pricing, the loan product, their ability to provide, to get that loan that you originally disclosed. So that would be information that was relied on became inaccurate. A joint applicant becomes unemployed, which changes the income amount relied on, or a required pest inspection shows evidence of termite damage, which requires further inspection. Here's one that happens. Creditor disclosed the appraisal cost for a single family dwelling. That's what you were told, it was a single family home. When they get out there, they realize it's on a farm, which has a higher appraisal cost. So that's a change on something you relied on. As long as the fee increased beyond the 10%, or with all other changes we're talking about, hits that 10% tolerance, or effects of loan pricing, like your origination fee, that zero tolerance, you can reissue a revised LE and make that one be the comparison for purposes of your good faith test. A change of new information that was not relied on. A neighbor of the seller filed a claim contesting the boundary of the property, thereby lowering the property value on which the disclosure relied. Here's a change affecting eligibility for an estimated charge, consumer's creditworthiness or value of security for the loan. So you see credit report delinquencies. That consumer is no longer eligible for a no-cost loan product or a no-appraisal loan product. Change requested by consumer, example. Consumer wants to grant a power of attorney to family member to consummate the transaction on his behalf. A revised LE can be shown to show increase in recording costs. Recording costs is zero tolerance. Change requested by the consumer, you should not have to eat that. That's the example for the right taking. I didn't make that up. Rate lock. If the rate was not locked, new LE must be issued even if nothing has changed, showing interest rate, points, lender credits, and other interest rate dependent charges and terms. This has been interpreted to include when the lock is extended or renewed as well. The loan estimate expires, and this is clear from the reg. The reg says 10 business days. My question is, if on the loan estimate we give up 20 days, can we still issue a revised loan estimate in 10 days? I would say that would be unfair and deceptive if you did that, but that's what the reg reads, 10 days. Construction loans. If you disclose that any time prior to 60 days, you can issue revised disclosures. Okay. The question had come up in a prior class about if the consumer changes their mind about what fees they're going to finance. So they're going to pay less on the down payment. So finance fees are going to be higher. That's going to change the loan amount, which will then change the taxes, the transfer taxes, right? So that's a 10% trigger, I think. Or is that zero? Zero. Thank you. I always star that. I would have you star this slide and the prior one. They're very important. So transfer taxes is zero variance permitted item. So the question is, it would depend on why the consumer is going to be financing more fees than originally thought. Do we have a change circumstance? Is it a change requested by the consumer? Yeah, sounds like it. But did we ask? Did we rely on that? Did we even find out before we issued those disclosures? What are you going to be financing? What is your down payment going to be? If we didn't ask, then we didn't make that disclosure, in my opinion, from the best information reasonably available. So that's something to think about. Gone are the days when the lender takes the application and then walks into the loan secretary and says, here, we're closing this. I mean, we need to have the communication. What fees are going to be financed? Who's going to be paying for what? What does the contract say? Pestons, all these other third parties. All right, let's take a break and turn our frowns upside down. We can get through this. And if there's any questions or discussions during the break, bring them up to me or to each other, and we'll
talk about it. The question that I just want to make sure. So you're saying just to list one?
Yes,
like
just
one.
Yeah.
Let's say the borrower says to be here, we pick it up. Why have
it doesn't matter.
It's on the 10%. That's what my lawyer says. It's on the 10%. That's not
right.
So when I'm out there testing this, if I see multiple abundance amounts in there, so the first one is, and all these are one, but not over the 10%, and I use numbers for my testing, my comparison.
Well, it depends on the reason for the change. If it was one of those top four, then you can use the most current one.
Correct, but if it was... No. But as far as these fees, this is kind of just saying for the most part, as also that like
Tell me what you think. I did this.
I mean, it's kind of except the appraisal fees, the appraisal head is in the 10%.
Most of this are just not required
options.
That's good.
Well, I guess
because
you're just the options.
You're
not
doing
that.
She's saying, where's the
numbers?
Is that the
26? I'm not saying I'm going to say that. 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 Some people don't love this, make it their life. All right, is everybody here who started here? Did you come back from the break?
The one in the back?
She's here. Okay, see her. I got my eyes. You guys may have heard the story about the college professor how the last day of exam, before everybody sat down, he said, if you guys want to leave now, you can do that. I'll give you a C. And half the people left. Like, I'm out of here. The other half sat down. got their pencils out, got ready, got the exam handed out to them, and the professor said, before you turn it over, I want to tell you it was a good semester. You guys really worked hard. I'm proud of what you've accomplished. You can turn your exams over now and begin. You turn the exams over, two sentences were on the sheet. Congratulations, you made an A.
Oh.
So you guys are here, you stayed, you didn't leave, you're gonna make an A. All right, this is the CFPB's resources page, and this is where I got the sample forms that are in your handout there. There's also, this is new to me, the question index for their webinars. Remember I said that Buckley Sandler had the transcripts. This actually goes through and tells you which webinar and what was the timestamp of these questions. So that's very, very helpful. I went on here actually to see if you could sign up on their website for the May 26th webinar they're putting out. I don't readily see it. So if you wanted, if you're not already on their website, to, you know, their Twitter or their Facebook or getting emails, and you didn't get the invite, if it came out the end of April, April 30th, just let me know and I'll email it to you. I'll forward on the invite. But once the webinar has been published, you can come back to this page, and under the videos, it will have the fifth one, and it's supposed to be their final one. So they've got their first four, and then the fifth one will be here right after that. So that's also where you can go to download and view that last webinar. So just quick before we get into the content of the loan estimate, there was a couple of items that were brought up during the break, and I don't even remember what they were. The provider listing has to be for providers that are able to service that particular loan. So if you have an application to purchase property in Colorado, you have to have providers that are capable of providing those services in Colorado. And the suggestion was made to call a financial institution in Colorado and have them help you find a third party that can be put on your list. You know, you just need to have a name if they can shop for it. And the other question had to do with rounding. And this is really geekdom, but thank you, Tammy. The rounding on the earlies is the early disclosure, there's no cents. Literally, there's no sense involved, but C-E-N-T-S, and we'll see that. But when you go to do your comparison for tolerance, you're supposed to use the unrounded amounts. So your loan operating system, if it's not doing the front end and the back end, it may not have those figures in there for you to do. If you're doing by hand, it's fine. But if you have, I think you had mentioned Calix, who's simply a front end provider, if you're also doing the closing, how are they going to know the operating system what those unrounded numbers are? And the thought was there was some kind of a bridge, maybe PACE you called it, Tammy, that Calix could use that would prepare a form for the third party, whether it's your investor or your settlement agent, to be able to prepare the closing disclosure from, so that data would feed in. You know, transferring information among all these parties is something that we're also having to deal with, you know, making sure that it's secure and safe and sound. One of the best practices audit checklist is how are the settlement agents able to provide information to and from the institutions in a secure environment. So there are software companies, and many of the big ones are providing a portal or a place for you to be able to input your information. Maybe it's even the software itself, so that another party can come in and access it and use that information to do what they need to do on it. Something we're going to hear more about, I think, as the industry relies on other parties to get the work done. So as far as the timing, when you have a change circumstance, it has to be issued a revised loan estimate within 3 business days after the change. Once you've issued a closing disclosure, and that 3 business days, remember, does not include Saturdays for purposes of a revised LE. Once you've issued a closing disclosure, which we're going to talk about later, you can't issue a new loan estimate. So the magic good faith estimate that used to show up at closing can't happen anymore. It actually, the closing disclosure has to go 3 business days prior to closing. So in effect, your loan estimate has to be delivered no later than 4 business days prior to closing. So what happens if there's a change circumstance later than 4 business days prior to closing? The reg makes it clear that you can show the revised charges on the closing disclosure, Once you've issued the closing disclosure, if there's more changes, then you can put the revised charges on the closing disclosure given at consummation. And the reg gives lots of examples of how things happen up until the morning of closing that need to be put on that revised closing disclosure. There is a controversy right now in the reg versus the very clear direction that the CFPB has given us in their webinars as to whether a closing disclosure can function as a revised LE for purposes of the tolerance test. Remember, we just went through all those tolerances tests. You have a reason, you have a change, you can issue a revised LE. If you've made it under the tolerance rules or one of the first four reasons, then that's gonna be the document against which you compare your closing disclosures to see if you owe any reimbursement. In my opinion, and based on the clear guidance from the webinar, you can use the closing disclosure to effect a change if you have a changed circumstance and have that closing disclosure be your comparison document. But admittedly, it's not clear. The reg itself doesn't specifically refer back to the closing disclosure when it's talking about a tolerance cure. So that's something we're gonna have to wait and see, and hopefully May 26 will answer, because it's a big deal. And the example the speaker gave, who I disagree with at FBA, the day of closing, the borrower requests a completely different loan or a completely different loan amount. You know, she said you have to eat the difference in any cost that that would affect on your for yourself, like for your creditor costs. I know, we're shaking our heads. That's not the way it is today. If that's what they meant, I'm sorry, the industry would have been up in arms to say, we can't do that. This is not fair, especially for borrower requested changes or changed circumstances. We have a defined group of things that constitute a changed circumstance. Up until the day of closing, these things happen. The issuance of a closing disclosure should not preclude your ability to make those changes for your borrower and not have to eat the difference. So that's my opinion, but it is admittedly up in the air. So we look forward to May 26 to answer that. Okay, the form itself, there's a lot less controversy involved on this, okay? So we're talking about page one of the handout. Does anybody cater to a significant number of Spanish-speaking consumers? Okay, the form is also available in Spanish, just so you know. All right, creditor name and address on the top. Can you see, I don't have these on the slides here, but you see FICUS Bank is the name of the creditor and the address has to be up there. If it's known, if you're a broker and you don't know who that loan is going to be ultimately made by, you can just leave that blank. Date issued is not the date printed. That's the date that this disclosure was delivered, handed, or mailed to the borrower, okay? Applicants, remember these, we do need to list all applicants, but it only needs to be delivered to the primary applicant unless it's rescindable, then it would be delivered to everybody. If there's more applicants that can fit in this space, you would have a separate sheet. These forms, with very few examples, are not model forms, they're standards. You can't move things around, you can't change, you can't expand or contract the number of fields. This is the way it is. So for those that are using hand printing, your form is gonna look, other than the handwriting, the exact same as the ones that are system generated. They're not gonna be able to make changes on the system. Property has to include zip code, sales price, if you have it, if you don't have it, if it's not a transaction with a seller, could be a refi or equity loan, you would use estimated property value. I'm just kind of reading from slide 16. You can use information from the applicant or their own estimate, or you could use the sales listing or some other value that you're using for the purposes of these disclosures. Once you get into the underwriting of that loan, you're gonna have to have a value that you're using, you know, in order to do your ability to repay and whatnot, and obviously the collateral value, then you would update that property value. Loan term, this is a simple 30-year loan term, but if it has some months involved, you gotta abbreviate that, and my slide there in 16 shows how that needs to be abbreviated. Purpose. I know you all have very creative lenders in your banks. But here's where we can't be creative. There's only one of four words that can go under the purpose field. It's either purchase, and it's in priority order as well. Purchase, refinance, construction, or home equity. So if something is not a purchase, or a refinance, or construction, it's gonna be a home equity, if we're talking about a rule, a loan covered by these rules. So a purchase means the funds will go to purchase the property that's identified here as property. That property, not another property, but that property. Refinance means, as it does under HMDA, we're satisfying a lien and paying it off on this property. Not refi on the 1003. Everything in the world is a refi. You know, cash out refi. There's no lien to begin with. So this may be a change for your lenders to understand. Purpose, refinance means we're paying somebody off. Construction, I think it speaks for itself, although a loan to construct the initial property, but also that conveys the underlying property, also fits the definition of purchase. So that's something the reg is a little unclear about. My opinion is you would select construction, even if the property is being purchased as part of that transaction, because otherwise nowhere else on this form will you see that it's a construction loan. Those words are not used. We don't have the same language we have today that says interest only on the amount outstanding will be paid during construction. We don't have that. So if we don't say construction on there, there's no way for anybody to know that it's a construction loan. Do you have a question?
Yes, I do. What if a home is free and clear?
Then it's a home equity loan.
And you're borrowing for to pay off bills.
Yep, home equity loan.
Home equity loan.
Yep, not a refi.
Okay.
Not a refi. So that's the home equity is going to cover all those catch-all situations. Loan ID. This comes from the creditor, and that needs to be consistent through the whole course of disclosures on this loan. So it's not necessarily the loan ID that you're booking on the system. This number needs to be determined at the time you're issuing the loan estimate, and it needs to stay with this loan. So there may be system challenges with identifying, once you've booked a loan, what loan on the app side or the closing disclosure side this is. It's not the loan number. It can be. If your system at time of application can issue a loan number and use that through and including the booking, then great, you have no challenges. Yours can. What is your system are you using?
Yes, it's compliance one, which I mean, you can auto generate,
okay,
you know, out of compliance one, but we've just got a spreadsheet on the wall. We haven't used that because prior to C1, we were already doing something else, so we just stayed with a manual process.
Okay, good, 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 good. All right, otherwise I want to just draw your attention to that rate lock box.
Kristen.
Yeah.
Question on that. What if, for whatever reason, you have a change of circumstance and change loan program? In other words, from an FHA to a conventional, the loan number may change, or secondary to in-house.
If you're not completely taking a new application, and closing one out, denying them, and starting over. You're keeping that application, you're doing a change circumstance, you know, for the change in loan program, then you would still keep the same number. You can do a dash, ABCD or something, to indicate that it's a different program, but the loan number needs to stay the same from the application through to closing. But your question brings a good point. I mean, under today's standards, many institutions would, if it went secondary to portfolio, would call it a whole new application. And that doesn't change under these rules. I can't think of a fact why that wouldn't change to start over and have a denial issued under. I mean, you could do a change circumstance if one of those reasons applied, keep the same applicant. Is that what you do now if it goes from secondary to portfolio?
We did a change in circumstance and redisclose, but
okay. Well, that would work too, except you're saying the loan number would not work for you.
And a lot of times when we initially disclose, we don't have the loan number yet because we haven't submitted it to the investor.
Correct. And the reg here says this comes from the creditor. If there is no creditor, that would be left blank. You don't just make it up.
Okay. You can leave it blank.
You can leave it blank. That's what
you.
The loan ID number you can leave blank? I thought you had to put it in.
Let me look at my slide.
I'm assuming Taylor's is gonna probably auto-generate some.
No, and my slide says, if available. So that's where it came from. If available.
Well, Calix assigns an application number, but that's not the number that would be the code. That would not be the number on the final document because it would depend.
But that's irrelevant.
But see, that's where I'm saying the number on the final document doesn't have to be your loan number that it gets booked under.
So if we put the Calix number there, it would suffice.
The Calix number would be fine because it would match the loan estimate number.
Yeah.
But how do you, somewhere you're gonna need a form or something that will bridge the gap between what did that loan get booked under? What is it
right.
now known as a loan number?
Right.
Yeah, this was a very difficult conceptually. Initially when I said this, I didn't think much of it, but every session there's been questions on this loan ID number. How does that really work in practice?
Another form.
What's that?
Another form.
Another,
yeah.
Well, internal.
The mapping of your loan ID number.
Yeah. So a loan ID from creditor if available, that's the answer to that, Tammy. All right, product is like a math problem here. I've got it circled on page one here. This is a 5-year interest only, 5/3 adjustable rate. And that's a defined methodology. Every creditor with a loan of this type is gonna have it described exactly this way. So let's look at how it has to go. First, you're going to describe the payment change feature, anything that has to do with how the payment would change. Again, in priority order, if it's NEGAM, interest only, step payment, balloon, or seasonal. It could have more than one. You would only pick one to describe it. So if it's a interest only balloon, it would just be described as interest only. You would not have in the product the word balloon because it would interest only trumps those others. So before the words interest only, you're going to describe the duration. 5-year interest only in this example. If it's a balloon payment is the choice that you have, you would describe year 7 or year whatever balloon payment. Product is the next component after the comma to describe what might happen to the interest rate. Is it fixed? Is it adjustable? Or is it step? Again, in that order. Now, an adjustable that has an introductory period is not fixed. That's adjustable. And so what you have to disclose before the words fixed, adjustable, or step is the duration of the initial rate. If it's not based on an index, so your teaser rate slash how long does that last slash how long does the next rate changes happen, the next initial rate change. So you can have multiple weird periods of when the rates are going to change. You would just disclose the initial rate period and the frequency after that for the first rate change. Okay, so again, it's a math problem. 5-3 adjustable rate, fixed for 5 years at the teaser rate, changes the third year after that. A 0/daily adjustable rate, that would be a loan that changes its rate daily based on a rate that's fully indexed. Whatever today's rate is, that's the initial rate, and the rate can change daily, like a construction loan, perhaps. Year 7 balloon, fixed rate. Okay, and if it's no introductory rate, so it's fully indexed, it's 0/3 adjustable rate. Okay, and then there's rules on what to do if it's not an even number of years. So for ability to repay, many of you guys came up with a 52-month balloon or a 52-month ARM loan, right? So that you got past the 5-year payment. You would actually disclose a decimal point. It's not a 5-year ARM, it's a 5.157 or whatever, 2 divided by 12 is. 62, right, thank you. 62, you're like, what? We're going too long. No, 62 for the 5 years, correct, thank you. You know, I'm not an accountant, I'm a lawyer. I really don't like numbers unless they're statute code sites. All right, loan type, very easy, conventional FHA, VA, or other, such as RHS for rural. Again, loan ID number is determined by the creditor. Lock bears some special attention. Most of you in here do not lock your loans. It's very easy. You say no. For those that do lock, you say yes, and how long is the lock through, good through? Does anybody notice anything particular about page one, rate lock, as far as when that rate lock expires?
It's a time.
The time, and specifically the time zone. EDT means Eastern Daylight Savings Time. So if it's not during daylight savings time, it would say EST. And we all know when daylight savings time starts and ends, don't we? Well, people know. Somebody out there knows. Actually, I've got it on my cheat sheet. Timeanddate.com has the November 1st. Until November 1st, we are in daylight savings time. Assuming we're not in Samoa or some of the Alaska, they don't follow daylight savings time. So your systems hopefully will build that in. And it'll ask you, what time zone are you in? And are you using? Isn't that great? All right, the other thing to point out on this is even if you don't lock your loans, this is a mandatory sentence. Before closing, your interest rate points and lender credits can't change unless you lock the interest rate. Makes it seem like you can lock your interest rate, but you can't. And you're just gonna have to have that conversation with anybody who might actually read that and say, well, I wanna lock my interest rate. It says I can. It doesn't say you can, it just says that everything can change unless you lock, which you don't. The next sentence says all other estimated closing costs expire on, and that's a mandatory sentence, even if you don't have a rate lock, that's how long the loan estimate is good for. Remember, 10 days is deemed, you can go longer.
Kristen.
Yeah.
If we have a rate lock, we have to have a signed form from borrower.
That's how that's been interpreted. Rate lock done casually or in your own internal files doesn't qualify as a yes on this checkbox.
Okay.
I have clients that don't have their clients sign a rate lock, but I guess now they're going to. Okay, the next section here is the loan terms. And that's where this, the study says this is the most important page. This is where the consumers get all their information. It's all on the one page. Loan amount, can it increase after closing, yes or no? And if it can, there's things that you need to describe. How far can it go? What kind of loan can increase after closing? Only example I can give is a neg am loan. That's it. So nobody's doing neg am loans, right? So we're gonna always say no. Interest rate is the initial interest rate. Then, and see there's no percentages after that because it's an even 4%. If there is 4.25 or 4.125, it's gotta go out three digits. 4.250 would be what you would disclose there. Can it increase after closing? Yes, and then how? Adjust every 3 years, high as 12%, and references an air table on page two. So if we just look quickly to page two, at the bottom right is the air table. If this loan was not an adjustable rate, this bottom section would be blank. So the form can't shrink or expand, but this is not required to be on here if it's not an adjustable rate loan. And on the bottom of page two, at the bottom right, it's the air table. And this is where particularities of the loan's interest rate change features are stated. Very simple and a table. Okay. This particular loan follows an MTA index. I'm not really familiar with that one so much. You would use the constant maturity or LIBOR or something like that. Monthly principal and interest, back to page one. The dollar amount of the first monthly payment of principal and interest. Now, in this case, this loan is interest only, so it's really just interest, and there's no disclosure of that in that loan terms feature, but down in the projected payments, it explains in bold that that payment is only interest. So then does the monthly payment change, yes or no? And if it does, then why? This is an ARM loan, so yes, the monthly payment can, in fact, increase. And then on the bottom of page two, on the left side, is the AP table, the adjustable payments table, and that explains the particularities of why the payment can change. It's interest only is why the payment can change, but also because of the interest rate change feature. So pretty much every ARM loan is going to have both of these tables filled in. Every interest only loan is going to have the AP table filled in. If it's also an ARM, it will have the other table. Make sense? Many of you with your loan types are going to have those tables filled out. Prepayment penalty, the answer probably to everybody in here is going to say no. Balloon payment could be yes or no. If you look to page 4 in the handout, I have a balloon payment example. So you can see the product type is a year 7 balloon payment. I've circled these for you. The balloon payment is, can this amount increase? Yes, you have a balloon payment, and here's what the balloon payment will be at the end of what year. And it's also shown in the projected payments. So notice that this loan has two columns of projected payments, years 1 through 7 and the final. That's because it's a fixed rate balloon loan. This loan does have escrow and mortgage insurance in there as well for years 1 through 7, but those aren't going to change through the course of this loan until it's paid off. Compare that with page 1. Page 1 has four columns, under projected payments. That's the max this form can have, 4 columns. But in those 4 columns, you're charged with the responsibility in your loan offerings, LOS systems, to describe critical payment changes over time. And there's rules built in by the reg as to what gets put in each column priority-wise. For example, if there's a balloon payment, that has to be the 4th column, or the last payment, I should say. But up until that time, there's rules on it. So interest only in this case, this has 4 changes. For the geeks in the room, like me, Stephen, and Tammy, and anybody else who hasn't shown their geekness to me, page 16 shows how these payments were calculated. This is my working paper for why this example is shown the way it is. So I show amortization for years 1 through 5 at an interest rate of 4%. It's no amortization, it's interest only, is $733. After that payment stream, principal will remain at $211,000. The next payment stream, when it's no longer interest only, and the rate, because it's a 5-3 arm, the rate could go as high as, and it's got 2% caps, it could go as high as 6%. It could go as low as 3.25, because that's the floor on this baby, that's the margin. So what would the payments be under either scenario? It's either going to be a low of $1,028.24 or a high of $1,359. And so that's the payment stream years 6 through 8. They're showing what the effect of the first major payment stream change is going to be. Okay, in this case, it still has mortgage insurance. Does anybody do loans with mortgage insurance occasionally? Those are a little bit more complicated because you've got built in there the time frames for when MI has to terminate. And usually, what is it, 78%, something like that? Yes, 70%. So then the next payment stream, again, worst and best case. Under the worst case scenario, what would the principal be? 199.023. So let's say what interest, the lowest interest rate possible and the highest interest rate possible, what would those payments be? And so that's where they get years 9 through 11. Okay, and then the following payment stream, which is their last one, has to actually capture the effect of 2 changes, P&I or MI changing, terminating, and then the next payment stream change, the interest rate going to the max, in this case, is the payment that they chose. The rate went up to 12%. So they're showing in the 4th column the effect of the maximum interest rate and MI being terminated. So that's much more geeky than most of you all need to know. But still, that's where it's coming from. Okay? And then at the bottom there, under that projected payments, they describe the range of estimated monthly payments in big, bold letters, numbers there. Okay. Estimated taxes, insurance, and assessments. This is independent of escrow. What are you using? This is the bottom table under, bottom row under projected payments table. It's page 1 still. This is the number that you're using on ability to repay to qualify your borrowers, which doesn't have to follow RESPA. You know, if you know that this loan, this is going to construct a home, and you're not bound by the construction vacant land taxes when calculating their monthly payment, you can use the improved property value. for both taxes and for insurance. This does not follow RESPA right here. You disclose what you're estimating, again, for their budgeting purposes, they might have to come up with monthly for, in this case, property taxes and homeowners insurance. In escrow, yes or no? In this case, they are not escrowing. All right, bottom, closing costs, costs at closing. These are a summary of the calculating cash to close, which is on page 2. It's a total of the closing costs, as well as the bottom number there of cash to close. So this number has been missing since 2010, when we changed our HUD forms. So now it's back by popular demand. And page 2 is where consumers may want to go to get more information on page 1. So the amount of cash to close made it to page 1, but the details of that calculation are on page 2. Any questions so far on page 1?
I have a question.
Yep.
It may not have been a change. I just want to make sure. Under the rate lock, mm-hmm. the 10 days, did anything change for that?
Mm-mm.
Said that there's you still, it's calendar, because that's calendar days, correct? Or business? No, it's
the expiration
days.
Of, well, let me ask, let me go back to you. The rate lock,
yeah.
The rate lock isn't affected by this. You either do or don't lock rates.
Correct. Well, if you don't lock a rate, that these, the 10 days that you choose, that they're.
For the rest of the items
correct.
That everybody has to adhere to, even if they don't lock, that
correct.
Has not changed. It's
that's
10 days and it does not count Saturday.
It does not count Saturday.
Right.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure.
Yep. Sure. Anybody else? All right, page 2, let's talk about origination charges. So this is similar to, but not the same as the original, the box, what is it, box 1, that we talk about our origination costs today. Today, you would lump third parties into that if they're performing origination services for you. Come August 1st, you don't. These are solely your charges. You're either going to fall, a fee is going to either fall into an origination charge to you or your broker or to third parties that they can or cannot shop for. And that's assuming it's something you require. If it's a charge that you don't require, it would go under H, other. H, section other. So let's go back to A, origination charges. The first line there, blank percent of loan amount points, that's mandatory, even if you're not charging points. And in this case, points are fees that reduce the interest rate only. You can call it what you want, but if you don't reduce the interest rate in opposition of them paying points, it's not a point, it's an origination fee or something else. And when I say you can call it what you want, don't take that the wrong way. You do need to be consistent in what the loan fees are at the time of loan origination and at the, or and at the time of closing. Because there's no line numbers anymore. We can't just look to line numbers to see accuracy. All in alphabetical order is how these go. So in this case, there is an application fee and a processing fee in alphabetical order after points, those get put on there. There's some concern in the industry on keeping fees relatively similarly described, especially say you're a title agent or you're closing loans for multiple creditors. How do you know what fees they call it, junk and they call it fax and they call it wire, how do you know what they're called so that you can be consistent? As of today, they say you guys can do what you want on fee descriptions, but there is a movement under the standardized mortgage MISMO, whatever it stands for, to have fees be very uniformly described. So up until now, we can be somewhat creative, but I would encourage you to get consistent fee descriptions from loan to loan to loan to loan. To the extent they're your fees, you can control that. B is the services you cannot shop for. So these are ones that you as the creditor are going to pick. Appraisal, credit report, flood, your attorney, and tax research. So these are in alphabetical order again. Now you can only have slide again, this form can't shrink or contract or expand. So if you have more than the 13 itemized fields here, you're gonna put it all into the last item and say total charges and you give a total. I think it says total. Additional charges, sorry, and you give a total. services you can shop for. So this is going to match your list, your settlement, your list of providers. All of these services here need to be on the shop for, identified on the shop for list. And they're in alphabetical order, and anything related to title needs to be unbundled. So that's a change from today. We were always bundling it under title services, and we didn't want to see the itemization. Now we want it itemized, but reference beginning with the word title, dash, and then alphabetized from there. So those are all required by the lender. Fees that you require, either your fees, third-party fees they can go buy whoever they want from, or third parties that you will select. Okay? Easy peasy. The other costs are a little bit different than today. Recording fees and other taxes get lumped together. So even though there's a different fee for recording the mortgage versus the deed, it's going to be one lump sum. And transfer taxes. Now, these are fees that the borrower is expected to pay. In this transaction, the borrower is not expected to pay the transfer taxes. Either the contract states that the seller is going to pay them, or in that community, it's typical that the seller would pay those transfer taxes. Okay? And that's true for, I would say, all items on here, with the possible exception of owner's title. Owner's title has some special rules right now. CFPB, for some reason, has owner's title on its mark, right? You guys could probably speak more to it. Owner's title, you can see down here under other, title-owner's title policy, parentheses, optional. That's a required language. So they want you to, as creditors, disclose that owner's title is not a mandatory purchase item. Now this is only in purchase transactions, not refis, where they've already got that, or they're not likely to pay that, or likely to have a part of the contract, because there is no contract with the refi.
Kristen,
yeah?
On the transfer taxes, if the norm is in our market that the seller pays the transfer taxes, so that's what we disclose. Then we get the contract in and we see, no, in this instance, the borrower's gonna have to pay them.
Right.
Then we do have a legitimate change circumstance.
That's right. Yep.
But how do we prove to our examiners that that's standard in our market? That
how do you do it today? I mean, there's...
We don't. We disclose on this a buyer paid item.
Okay.
We just don't take risk.
Yeah. I guess I would say if 9 out of 9 loans we looked at, the buyer is paying the transfer taxes, then you would have a hard argument to make to me to say it's standard in your community that the buyer, that the seller pays. If 9 out of 10 we look at, the seller's paying, and one, because the contract was X'd out or marked through or something, then clearly that's not common in your community. And every community is different. Here it's more likely than not the seller will be paying. Is that correct?
Yeah, actually the real estate contract is basically happened underneath the seller's place. I mean, you got to check a box or whatever. But
it's expected,
I mean,
to be
usually
part of the seller's.
Yeah, when you look at the contract, it says seller's cost.
Yeah.
And then like 9C, if you go down for the title, if they're
paying
down.
Yep.
Generally, it's underneath the seller's paragraph.
Okay.
In the contract.
And that's the Florida uniform contract?
Florida contract.
Because I know by geographic region that the opposite is the case sometimes in areas of South Florida, and I think, well, that's not Florida, but Alabama has differences. So you really need to know it, and that's where the services of a good settlement agent will come in handy. Or realtors, you know, third parties, getting to know what is in that geography for that home. But proving it up to the, you know, to the examiners, to Tammy's point, but they don't want fees on here that aren't likely to be paid for by the borrower. That's clear. It muddies up the process. But, and when you get a contract in, you're going to need to document that you got it, and then it's different.
At that point, would that justify a change circumstance if
yeah.
we disclose the transfer taxes?
Yes.
We get the contract, and there the seller's paying for them?
Yeah. That's one of those things that would be unique to the circumstances of that loan.
What about flood? I assume that would be, you find out later it's in a flood zone, you can redo it.
Right, yep. Sure. Flood is not an item that is subject to a tolerance, so we're
right.
not as concerned about, you know, having
yeah,
to issue a flood.
Yeah, would you even have
to? You would not even have to.
You wouldn't?
Nope.
Okay.
Now, could you or could you somehow let the borrower know that things are changing if they have to have flood insurance? Obviously, you're going to send them a notice, but a revised loan estimate on a new meeting flood insurance is not required. It's not going to count for anything other than telling the consumer. And you do have to balance too many loan estimates in file versus not. So that's really kind of your decision, your call. I would suggest you don't do a revised LE for that.
Even though it'll change the RESPA rules?
Yeah, it's going to change a lot. But remember, you're issuing a closing disclosure with all of these changes going to be in it 3 days prior to closing. So it's not like they're going to get surprised at the closing table for most of these changes. It would change their escrow. It would change quite a bit.
Yeah.
But you can have that conversation off the loan estimate and not have to reissue the whole loan estimate. Okay. So just a minute on the loan. Prepays, I think these are all pretty much standard with what you're using. The escrow, here at escrow, just to mention, there's no aggregate adjustment, so you would just initially disclose what your cushion, I guess I should say, your prepaids, however many months in advance for homeowners, mortgage, and property taxes, and you can add up to 5 more additional items, but no aggregate accounting adjustment. So here's other examples of what would go in other. These are items that are not required, again, to be paid by the creditor. So credit life, appliance. Here's one, real estate and related commissions. If your buyer is going to be paying commissions, which is not usually the case, right? But if you get a contract that for whatever reason states otherwise, you would disclose that. An inspection fee not required. I wanted to, this is an additional slide, it's not in your printout, but this, actually one of Patty's slides had this example on the left side, I thought it was good. So for the title agents in the room, this is a big sticking point right now with your industry. Are you familiar with this? The disclosure of fees for owner's title and lender's title? Currently, if, as I understand it, if simultaneous lenders and owners policies are issued, the discount gets applied to the lender's policy. And the owner's policy, which is usually paid for by the seller, has the full premium rate. Yes. Under the disclosure rules, you have to disclose the opposite. They want you to disclose the full premium of a lender's policy and apply any discount to the owners, so that it would affect show the incremental increase on a net basis of having a simultaneously issued owner's policy. So I've got the map here to show you. Here's how the reg describes it. You disclose the full owner's policy, adding in the simultaneous issue premium for the owner's policy, and subtract out of that the lender's full premium. But a way that the way I think about it, that I like the way Patty described it, is you're basically going to get the difference between what is the full premium for a lender and the discounted premium for the lender that you're going to be charging the lender. Find that difference and apply it to the owner's policy. Discount it from the owner's policy. So that at the end of the day, the total charges for title insurance on this loan are going to be $1,316. But the allocation between lenders and owners is going to show differently. So off sheet or on your front at the adjustments, you're going to have to make adjustments for that, because typically the seller, again, is going to be paying the owner's title policy, right? The lender would not be paying the full premium. In reality, they're going to be paying that lower discounted rate, that 462. And the seller would be paying 854, but you're going to disclose 608 and 708.
Kristen, I can tell you the last time we went to title company say he hadn't resolved it, because it's actually a regulation that says you pay for the owners and give the discount for the lenders.
Okay, is that state statute?
It's an issue.
Yeah, 25 states do it that way.
Right, and there's, the last time we saw it, and everyone was saying it wasn't final, you're actually going to end up showing a double payment, and then there's going to be a credit. So it comes out to the same thing, but you're going to have someone knowledgeable explain it.
Yep.
To say, because it almost, when you disclose it, it's going to look like you're paying double. So you got to be able to point to the no, this is where you're getting the
credits.
So you're really only paying the $25 for the simultaneous issue. But what the last we saw, what it amounts to is you've just got to understand how to explain it. It doesn't net affect anything, but if a real estate agent just glances at it and reviews them like they usually do, if they're not aware of it, they're going to think you're charging double and then your clients.
Okay. When we get to the closing disclosure, show me, is that credit shown on the closing disclosure itself,
yes,
or is it on another sheet? You can put it on the closing.
Is it shown that line item, or is it shown on the front over the credits or general line?
We'll look at it.
Definitely one of the things we highlighted.
Oh, the industry is up in arms over it, and they keep thinking that CFPB is going to change, but CFPB seems to be adamant that no, they want it disclosed this way.
And I think the concern is the title agents are going to get criticized by their regulators because it shows you're charging it more.
Right. Yep.
So it's a tricky thing. It's the federal reg is inconsistent with the state statute.
Well, that's.
But
Trump state statutes, always.
You're talking about,
yeah, I understand, yeah,
title agents that aren't regulated by the feds. This is the first time the feds have been credited.
Right, but I guess what I'm saying is because we know a lot of for the form, therefore,
well, that's what the issue is.
Since the banks are liable, it seems like you would have to go with the federal.
It's going
to
be this way. It's a matter of, unless they change the law, this is going to be the way it is. And I don't think they're going to change it. I mean, I've been wrong before, but they know about this issue. 25 states are doing it the way Florida does it, and they say, too bad, it's so sad. In fact, they've addressed it in their toolkit to say, this is how it's disclosed, which may differ from what you see at the closing statement or on a sheet by your title agent. Yep.
If I'm understanding that right, and assuming that the borrower is going to pay for both, it really doesn't matter, it's just what you're showing. But if you got a situation where the seller was paying for the owners and the borrower had to finance their home, then the Consumer Protection Bureau, the Financial Protection Bureau, is actually harming the borrower. Because they now are going to pay more under this way than they would have.
There should be no effect to what really happens at this closing table. The seller should be paying for the actual cost, the higher cost of lenders. This is just showing the incremental increase for purchasing owners, whether it's paid for by the seller or the lender or borrower. My understanding is at the end of the day, the adjustments will be made, so the seller will be paying the higher amount. Is that correct?
Right.
Yeah.
So
it does have an effect on
today's rules.
Monetarily, where it doesn't.
Right.
It hits the same thing. You just got to add.
Yeah. There's going to be an adjustment made on the other page of the at the closing to disclose to account for the seller paying the full $708.
Okay.
Do you know if anybody's
$854
sessions for the realtors so they can learn how to understand this stuff?
First International is not like that.
Really.
Realtors
need to go.
Realtors do? That'll be Fort Myers. We'll see how that goes. All right, we got to move along here. I want to get through all the materials. So just a comment on lender credit. That's here under J. This would be a total of whether it's specific lender credit, like I've given an example, we'll pay for the appraisal, or a no-cost loan lender credit. You don't disclose any more lender credit as part of the interest rate or, you know, anything like you do under the current standards, if you have a true lender credit, because you also aren't disclosing secondary indirect payments to your brokers. Only direct payments to brokers go under loan costs. But in lender credit would be where you have a no-cost loan, like I said. Okay, and that dollar amount is subject to zero tolerance, as I mentioned earlier. Whatever you put in here as a dollar amount on lender credit needs to stay the same at the end of the day, unless there's a change circumstance. Okay, I'm not gonna go into great detail on the adjustments or the calculating cash to close. I will say that there is an alternative to this form on page 5 and 6 of the handout for refis. Page 5 is page 1 of the loan estimate, and at the bottom, the estimated cash to close looks different. It's just got a checkbox, funds to from borrower. Page 6 has a smaller version of calculating cash to close than a loan to a seller would, or with a seller. Because with a seller, there's seller credits, there's adjustments, down payments, and that such. Here, on a loan without a seller, it's much simpler. Notice on page 6, there's no air table or AP table. That's because it is a fixed rate loan. Okay? Additional information. Let's go to page 3, because it's fun. Whew, see how you guys like this one. All right, top information is, you know, NMLS numbers of the lender and the loan officer. Comparison. So this is finally where we see the APR that used to be considered like the most important number ever. And now it's relegated to page 3, which they say is really for the most interested consumer. What we have here in 5 years, so we're disclosing to them, because most consumers stay in their home between 5 and 7 years, how much in interest and total loan costs will they have paid in 5 years on this loan. This figure does not include any lender credit, so if you're doing no-cost loans, you're not going to be as competitive with others that are, you're gonna look the same as a full-cost loan, because it does not allow you to take out your lender credit. And also in 5 years, what is the principal you paid off? Consumers found that to be an important number. This is an interest-only loan, so zero is how much principal was paid off. The next item, annual percentage rate. There's been no changes to how the APR is calculated. Do not get confused with the original proposed rule in the Dodd-Frank Act that wanted everything and their mother to be brought into the APR. That has not changed. The only thing that's changed on here is the sentence, which is very helpful. This is not your interest rate. Okay, that's what we've been telling consumers since 1969. Now the next item, total interest percentage. That's a really, really big number, and it's pretty much always going to be, even on a very low interest loan. This is the amount of interest over the life of the loan as a percentage of the loan amount. So how do you explain this to a consumer? I mean, my best answer is to tell a consumer that, you know, the bulk of every dollar you pay us is going to interest. And so if you, to the extent you can, pay down extra payments, that number will significantly decrease. I mean, it's a function of interest over time, right? And it goes the other way on the savings account. You know, you can earn interest quicker the more you put into savings. Same thing on the loan side. I mean, it's just an extraordinarily high number. And the consumers had mixed results, actually, on it. But it was required with Dodd-Frank, and because there was some consumers who thought it was valuable, it got to stay here.
Well, they've had it on the till all these years anyway. I mean, the total amount of interest that they pay on the
in a dollar figure.
Right, in a dollar,
yeah,
right.
Big giant dollar figure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they always thought, whoa, I'm paying that much.
Well, I think, I mean, the dollar percentage is one thing too, but when you see it at percent, right underneath the annual percentage rate, which was hard enough to explain this isn't your interest rate,
yeah.
This just elevates that conversation to another, you know, another doorway we got to go down.
I think that whole thing about the title insurance and the confusion with that is comparable to the way we've always had to explain the APR. I mean, you're going to have that same
conversation.
Yeah.
It's all fantasy. It's fictitious.
Yeah,
it's what
it's smoke and mirrors.
Smoke and mirrors, yeah. Well, at least with that, you can say this is the incremental increase for the cost of insurance of an owner's policy. But it goes back still to the fact that we're optional. You know, how much really are you going to have that conversation? Will they be purchasing it? Because that's cash out of their pocket. Even if it's, you know, of course, if the seller's paying, which is most likely the case, then it's not so bad. That's another conversation, yeah. That goes back to, should it even be on the form if the seller's paying it? Mm-hmm. In my opinion, it shouldn't. The general rule is that loan estimate should only have the fees that the borrower is likely to pay. But that particular one is not clear. The reg is actually, this is beyond this geekdom, but the reg is written in a way that you can interpret it either way. It says fees in that section, fees the borrower is likely to pay or by contract with third parties other than the investor or the creditor or originator will pay. It's like, does that mean the third party will pay it? Or through contract with those third parties, the borrower will pay it? That's how I interpret it, but you can interpret it, and experts have to say it means if through contract with third parties, a third party will pay that fee. That's a little bit more geekdom. Just know right now that it's up in the air as to whether a owner's title policy that is not to be paid by your borrower should even be on there. And the one thing that makes me think it should is that all the drama has gone around this issue, and if it could be taken off in the event the seller is going to pay it, then it wouldn't be so dramatic. It wouldn't be such a high issue. So we have to wait and hear on that one too. Other considerations, this is where we can get rid of some of those pages of paper that we're already handing out. The appraisal to copy disclosure in a transaction subject to this rule can go. Now, this disclosure doesn't have to be given out if you've denied a loan within 3 days, but the appraisal disclosure does. So that's a little concerning. You may want to put this appraisal disclosure on your applications as well, so that you're making sure the consumers get a copy of their right to the receive and appraisal. Until we hear otherwise, that's the ruling. Assumption, easy enough. Homeowners insurance, late payment, refinance if it's a refinancing. They don't bear much discussion, but servicing does. You have to disclose whether you will or whether you will service or whether you will transfer the loan. Currently, you have this option to say we may or may not. We don't know. That option's gone away. You have to commit to either you will service or you intend to transfer servicing. And then this is also the part where you would put in, if you had a construction loan, the fact that you reserve the right to issue a revised LE within 60 days of the closing. The confirmed receipt, it's not mandatory that this form be signed. Just like today, right? The good faith estimate does not have to be signed. But if you don't have this signature line, then you do not have to accept this loan because you have signed or received this form language needs to go up under other considerations. So who's going to not have their borrower sign the loan estimate? I wouldn't have them sign the loan estimate, but if we get to the closing disclosure, that may be a different matter. Okay. Closing disclosure timing, I mentioned it had to be delivered at least 3 business days before consummation. This is a huge change. Today, the APR, or the good faith, the HUD settlement statement is the day before closing, if we're lucky. Otherwise, it's the day of. So this form functions as the HUD settlement statement, 3 business days prior. So we haven't talked about this previously, this mailbox rule. On any of the regs where they have to have received the document, which really it's just this and the intent, to get the intent to proceed, they would have had to receive the loan estimate. You've got this mailbox rule that if it's put in the mail or sent by email, it's presumed received 3 business days after that you put it in the mail or emailed it, unless you have evidence of earlier delivery. So evidence of earlier delivery on a U.S. mail, I guess, would be signed certified receipt, sent signed through certified mail, or if you send it through FedEx, or UPS where a signature is required to be received, and you see that your consumer signed it on an email. I don't know. I mean, some services have to have your consumer come in and log in, and you know that it's them. Outlook has an automatic reply, which I would caution you does not mean your consumer got it. It means that somebody, some server somewhere opened it. The guidance gives as an example an email that was returned with by your borrower acknowledging receipt. So if that happens, then delivery on the third business day prior to closing suffices. You've delivered it, they've received it. But if that's not the case, then you may need to back it up to get that three business day presumption and actually send these out six business days prior to closing.
Kristen.
Yeah.
We seem to do a lot of loans, you know, purchases where, say you have a husband and wife, but the husband is the only one on the note.
Mm-hmm.
Do we need to have proof of receipt of the closing disclosure from the wife since she has to sign the mortgage?
No.
Okay.
She doesn't have rescission rights. She's not a borrower. She doesn't get it at all.
In the state of Florida, does she have rescission rights?
She said purchase.
Oh, yeah,
purchase. But if it was a refi, you're correct.
Well, I mean, she has to have a TIL because she owns the property. In the old rates, we had to give her a TIL. So that's why I was wondering if.
Not on a purchase. I don't know where that would come from. Borrowers get the copy of the TIL. She's just hypothecating a write in it. Same thing on a CD. Somebody hypothecates a CD, they don't get the TIL. As long as we're not talking rescission, that changes everything. But if it's a purchase, only borrowers need to get this. Okay, so there's your example. Closing disclosure, okay. We're gonna look at it, you know it's got the APR. There is a rule, once you've issued the closing disclosure, if something happens to make it inaccurate, you can reissue it. But if that inaccuracy involves the APR, a loan product change, or adding a prepayment penalty, that free business day pre-delivery window we just talked about starts over. Only under those three circumstances though. So that's pretty good. Now I say APR becomes inaccurate. There is commentary and people think, well, if it's over-disclosed, does that count? It can, depending on why the APR was over-disclosed. Most over-disclosed APRs come from including too many fees as a finance charge. And if that's the case, that's deemed to be accurate. So you don't have to worry about it. In most cases, I will go out on a limb and say, if you've over-disclosed your APR on your closing disclosure, and at the time something changes and you realize that the APR is lower, you wouldn't trigger a new three-day period. Any other changes you're going to disclose at or before consummation, there's no new waiting period. As I said, there is a 1 day prior inspection period if requested. And I say here, only changed circumstances will allow the good faith analysis for the 0 or 10% variations. But remember, there's still out on some commentary that makes it unclear if the closing disclosure will reset your tolerances or if only the final loan estimate is the tolerance trigger. Now, this is new too. After consummation, there's a duty to correct the disclosures if something is discovered that made them inaccurate. And the most common scenario, and attorneys help me, the only common scenario I found is the recording fees are different than what we thought they were when it comes time to actually record those documents. Have you had other situations where the fees at the settlement changed and it was discovered after settlement? Recording fees. If that's the case, then it you would have to, recording fee, yes, is a redisclosure. Within the 30 days post-consummation, if you learn about a change, then you have another 30 days to provide new disclosures of that change. So it's basically a 60-day window post-closing that you need to monitor this loan to see if there's any changes that made the settlement, the amounts paid by that consumer at settlement different, a refund or an overpayment. non-numerical clerical errors, the example they give in the reg is a payee name changes, then you do need to send out a revised closing disclosure as well. What's that?
Closing. You're saying that if something changes, we go back. I mean, you are, you got a note, they've signed, you got it, what are you going to do, everything?
No, just the distribution of the fees on the loan, on the closing disclosure, which we'll get into, but it's very similar to the loan estimate. Like, not your note amount or your interest rate, those things can't change. They're legally obligated, as are you, to that document. But we're talking about fees. And the example is they close everything, we send it off to get recorded, and maybe there's an additional page or there's something that that recording fee, or maybe it was less than what we thought it was and what was disclosed by the consumer on the settlement statement.
If it's more, we just absorb it.
If it's more, you just absorb it. My interpretation is you would still need to send a revised closing disclosure showing the increased fee with a lender credit for the absorption. I know. I guess they just wanted to be really, really accurate, but that's, I mean, maybe that's something we'll get more guidance out of. Because they actually give examples of cures where you're going to just eat it, they still want to send the revised closing disclosure showing the lender credit. The lender credit, if you look on page 15, is showing the effect of a lender credit. This is jumping ahead. I want to get into the actual fee itself. Here's the here's the credit for a refund within 60 days. If amount paid exceeds the threshold or exceeds the prohibition on any charge, you have safe harbor from liability if you refund and redisclose within 60 days. So that's two. Now, that's not the situation you're talking about. So maybe I can check in and see if there's any more guidance on what if we just absorb the recording fee overage. Certainly, if it's the other way around, you need to give them their money back and redisclose. Okay. Okay. Okay, let's look at the closing disclosure.
We have a question.
Yeah.
Does that last closing, the redisclosure after closing, does it have to be signed?
No, none of these have to be signed.
No.
So that one would be just like the others. On page 7 starts the actual closing disclosure. There is a separate form that's available for transactions separate to the seller. I don't have an example in here, I don't think. But in that case, the settlement agent would prepare the seller side, and they have to require, they have to provide that document to the creditor. You as the creditor have to keep a copy of both sides, essentially, of this transaction. Okay. All right, date issued again. This is the date of delivery. This case, to see the date issued is the same as the closing date, so this closing disclosure was provided to them at closing. We're assuming that they've met the 3 business day prior at a different closing disclosure. Here's the new one at closing. Settlement agent is the person that is, or the company that's closing the loan, not the individual person. File number is the settlement agent's file number. All of these are very similar to what we've already looked at on the loan estimate. The only difference is down here under estimated taxes, insurance, and assessments, here you have to follow the RESPA escrow rules if the loan is subject to RESPA. So like a construction-only loan still is not subject to RESPA. You have to use these disclosures, but you don't have to follow escrow rules for disclosing their estimated insurance taxes and whatnot. It's a little confusing, but for some reason, and I've got these on your slides when you go back to reference them. Page 8, this looks a little different than the breakout that we have on the settlement and the loan estimate. Here we have columns for those paid by the seller and by third party. So remember, On the loan estimate, it's a general rule, you don't disclose fees that are not going to be paid by your customer, your consumer. Here on the settlement statement, you're paying, you're disclosing all fees, even those paid by third parties. And you would put them in the representative columns. Otherwise, origination charges, same rule. Now, this document can stretch in compact. You're not limited to just the number of the spaces here. This has 8 spaces. You can, software can expand those.
Kristen.
Yeah.
Today, under the good faith, like if we disclose a fee is paid by the buyer, and then we discover no, in fact, it's actually going to be paid by the seller, but we don't disclose until closing, so to speak. Under the rules, you would still list it on your HUD as a buyer pay item, and you would put it on the front sheet as a seller credit. You don't put it in the seller's column.
Okay.
But reading through this, it almost sounds like you, if you discover it after you've already done the loan estimate, you still put it, you don't put it as a seller credit on that section, but you actually put it on the line item. It looks like it's different.
It is different.
Okay.
Are you saying if you discover before closing that a fee you disclose is being paid by your borrower is going to be paid by the seller?
Yes.
You do not have to issue a revised LE showing that, but
right.
Say you did, you can make it disappear.
Right.
And it's not even on there. When it comes time to the closing disclosure, that fee needs to go back on there in the seller's column.
Right. We had a situation that came up recently where we had disclosed that the buyer was paying a fee. Looking at the contract, we realized, no, the seller was paying. Well, then the question became, which column does it go on the HUD? So we went to the regulation, we're really reviewing it. Today, the regulation says, stated, you still list it in the buyer column and you put it on the front of the HUD as a seller credit.
That's right.
But when I'm reading through this, it sounds like that has changed.
Yeah.
So today, in that same instance, we would put it on that specific line item.
Yeah.
And the only time we would put a seller credit is if it was sellers paying $3,000.
Exactly, a general credit. If it's attributed to a specific cost, it goes on the seller paid column next to that cost, whatever it is. If it's a flat $3,000 towards closing cost, it's gonna go as a seller credit, which would be on page 9, you can see it, number L5, seller credit. The seller is paying $2,500 towards closing costs. This case on page 8, the third party fee is the appraisal fee paid for probably by the lender in this case, because we can't imagine some random stranger walking by and offering to pay the appraisal fee. But you can put an L, however that goes, next to the $405 so that it's clear it's paid for by the lender. You don't have to. So the total loan costs get added. I mean, it's the same thing. Services borrower did not shop for and did shop for, that changes because it used to say can and cannot. So this is at the end of the day, which one did they shop for and which one they didn't. So clearly did shop for, unlimited tolerance, right? Because they went off their list. They went and picked somebody. Did not shop for means either the creditor picked them or they picked somebody off of, on the list. So those are your 10% tolerance levels there. Or if they were not allowed to shop for it, zero tolerance, like flood appraisal. Okay? This case, credit report fee was paid before closing. So we total those up. We get down here under taxes and other government fees, they're split out. Deed and mortgage are separate. Transfer taxes, we can see here on this sheet that the seller is paying those. Remember on the original good faith, they weren't, or loan estimate, they weren't even there. Prepaids, that speak for themselves. Initial escrow payment, here we do have the aggregate adjustment. In this case, it's just a penny, but many times it could be more than that. Other, there we go back to the non-required fees as part of this transaction that came up through the contract or whatnot. Real estate commissions being paid for by the seller, inspections paid for by the seller, etc. And there's the owner's title insurance optional. Other costs are total, and then we get to the closing costs where we subtotal the closing, the other costs with the loan costs, and then we would affect any general lender credits, not the specific ones. Okay, seller paid, I just circled that because those are not added throughout the course of this document. It's only at the bottom are they totaled. Just again, trying not to have confusion with too many numbers. TMI. Okay, page 9. This calculating cash to close is the same as what was on the loan estimate, except there's this comparison to the final. Did this change? So this is not the same as what we have under today's rules, where you do a comparison of the fees that are allowed to change, fees that are not allowed to change. That's gone. There is no on-sheet comparison for your tolerances. I mentioned that. You're going to have to go with your LOS system or your own internal process to do comparisons. Here, all they're saying is, did it change, yes or no? And if yes, they will print the section on both the loan estimate and the closing disclosure. So in this case, total closing costs changed. It went from $88,000 to $9,700. Did it change? Why? They referenced the itemization. And it even says on the top, use this table to see what has changed from your loan estimate. So they're going to have to bring their loan estimate or look at it 3 days prior to closing to make their comparison. You're not going to do that for them. In this case, closing costs went up, but there's no reimbursement required for that. They either had a changed circumstance or they had something that was a zero, unlimited tolerance, I should say. Because if there was a lender reimbursement, we would see it, like I mentioned on page 15. Page 15 shows the calculating cash to close with a lender credit for total closing costs. It says it went from $5,099 to $5,977. Did this change? Yes. See with total loan costs and total other costs, and then it goes on to say increase exceeds legal lending limit or legal limit by $200. See lender credits on page 2. Okay, so not every increase is going to have a lender credit or an adjustment. Summary of transactions here. This is what we would call the what would be similar to the page 1 of the HUD right now. So you would reference out who's paying what to the end of the day, where you get ultimately cash to or from borrower and cash to or from seller. And this class is not the place to go into a lot of detail here, but that's the advanced class later where we'll talk about filling this out. I could just tell you that there are some nuances. One of them has to do with the deposit with the broker. That's any deposit that's in the broker's hands gets treated differently today as it will under the new rule. Those would be described in a future presentation because I can't seem to find my notes on how that works. It's really not something that makes a lot of sense to me. That's why I don't have it in the top of my head. I just made a note of it on this sheet. Otherwise, here's what you would put in the paid by borrower. So these are items from the reg talking about seller credit, which is a general credit, which we talked about. So like a builder, the particular credits would be disclosed in the seller paid column. If there's items at walkthrough prior to closing, they would be listed here as adjustments. Other credit on paid by borrower would be like a real estate agent rebate. Paid by borrower LO4 would be subordinate lien financing or subordinate financing proceeds. I do want to make it clear, you can't close more than one loan on a closing disclosure. Each loan has to have their own. But you can reference, obviously, the proceeds from the subordinate financing to make all the balancing work out on your first mortgage, on your first mortgage purchase loan. Paid by borrower, that's where you would put in your payoffs of other loans in LO4. L7 would be like gift funds paid by borrower. And there are, and I'm hoping to get my hands on some of the title industries worksheets. You had mentioned, Beverly, I think, Barbara, I'm sorry, on case studies for filling these out, for worksheets and samples. That's what I'd like to get my hands on for a subsequent class. So if you could help me out with that, that would be great. As auditors, we haven't spent a lot of time on page one of the HUD. You know, other than if they affected the credit or something to do with the loan transaction, we really hadn't paid much attention to the adjustments between the buyer and the seller. So I'll just have to get back to you on the deposit and the broker's amount because there's some funny adjustments that need to be made to that. So for now, page 10.
Here.
Overtime. I just want to talk about this partial payments. Most of these we've already mentioned with regard to the loan estimate. You will need to disclose whether you accept partial payments as a matter of practice or whether, depending on the circumstance, you won't accept them or if you never accept them. So there's three boxes there to check. You can check one and two, or you can check three. So some lenders will accept partial payments as long as the loan's current. And if it's not current, they'll put them in a suspense account or some other holding account. So you would check both one and two. If as no matter what, you'll accept partial payments, you just accept check box one. On the escrow account, this is new. Whether you're escrowing or not, who doesn't escrow here? We have a lot of lenders that do not escrow at all. Then you would have to complete the bottom section of this column that says you will not have an escrow account because your lender does not offer one. And even still, you're going to give them an estimate of, for, you know, the fees that you would assume that they'll be required to pay over time. The fees that you use in your ability to repay calculation, frankly. You are already calculating these. On page 11, this is either what we've already talked about on the loan estimate or it's figures that come from today's Fed box. For those of you that will finance bank-owned property, like you're the seller as well, you're used to seeing a fifth box up there called the total sales price. That's gone. For loans that are subject to this rule, if you're the financing seller, That box is not provided for in these rules. I've copied there the liability after foreclosure. This is a new disclosure required by Dodd-Frank, and you disclose whether under state law provides anti-deficiency protections. Florida does not, other than a statute of limitations. Alabama does not. Georgia does not. I would imagine California does. You know of any other states that do have anti-deficiency protection built in, where a seller creditor couldn't go after the deficiency on a foreclosure? I don't know of any. Confirm receipt shows that they received it, signed it. That's not mandatory. What is the title industry thinking about this field? Has there been any comment? You're always used to getting the HUD settlement statement signed, right?
I can't imagine closing a loan without
I agree 100%. I mean, I think with the early delivery, you're not necessarily going to want to get the signature back because then it's just more things to track. And if some files have it signed and some don't, this could indicate a problem. I mean, that's one course of action would be to say, we mail it out, we can document the mailing with the cover letter, the date, and all that. But at closing, we get them to sign up. The last and final closing disclosure. Because that's just, to me, it's obscene to not have that sign. It doesn't make any sense. Right, this is the bottom line. Contact information, if the information is, if the party is a party to the transaction, you've got to disclose their name and address, any licensing information, their email or phone number. Okay, just real quick, there are two disclosures that have to be made outside of the loan estimate and the closing disclosure. If you're a purchaser of loans, your hello letter needs to have on it, what is your payment, partial payment policy? Does anybody here purchase loans? No? And then if you have escrow, when you cancel it, for whatever reason, either you cancel it or the borrower requests it to cancel, you'll have to send a post-closing cancellation notice. And I have an example of that in your materials, page 18. Record retention, because some of these rules do come from RESPA, there's a different record retention period, but think 5 years for the closing disclosure, and so that's probably gonna be how long you're gonna keep your loan files. That is true even if you sell the loan. If you're the creditor, you have to keep the closing disclosure for 5 years after the closing. Actually, after when the disclosure was made. So because you have that 60-day tail after closing that you may have to do a revised disclosure, you should think 5 years and 2 months. You know, 5.15 years. 2 years for those post-closing notices we talked about, and 3 years for everything else as far as the whole file for the loan estimate and closing disclosure. Private right of action, this is a little messy because today, under the RESPA rules, your consumers can't sue you. It's only in government that can enforce those actions on you. Even if you're doing kickbacks, you name it, anything illegal under RESPA, consumers can't sue you. Under this rule, everything that related to the good faith estimate gets moved over into truth in lending. Truth in lending does have a private right of action. So the concern is if you make a mistake in your disclosure, even if it's cured by tolerance, is there other rights of action that your consumers can bring against you? We don't know the answer to that. CFPB's answer is, well, you have to go back to the originating requirement, did it come from RESPA or Truth in Lending, to say whether the consumer has a private right of action. The reality is, as you guys may know, we were all scared about litigation over ability to repay. We haven't seen that bear yet. I mean, granted, it's only been a year and a half, but still, we may not see this to be a big issue either with litigation. I think the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, maybe not even the FDIC, are concerned about you guys filling these forms out. You know, at the end of the day, as long as you're not being unfair and deceptive, or obviously not increasing your fees and not repaying tolerance, then you'll be okay. I foresee the biggest write-ups you'll get is the documentation. How do we know which is your last loan estimate? How do you know, how are you documenting your changed circumstances? I'm hopeful that at the end of the day, business as usual. Something you can do, even though the effective date isn't until August 1st, you can try having your disclosures ready 3 days prior to closing now. Work with your third parties and say, let's just do a dry run and see if we can get our information together. Because when they're pointing fingers in that triangle, you don't want them to point at the creditor. Because that's what I hear or see, is that they do blame the creditors for not having their information coming. All right, and these are just the three things that are effective regardless of application date. So there's our consultants at Saltmarsh and shareholders. Thanks for coming. We're going to be here through lunch. Help yourself if you can stay. And we said we were going to have debriefing, cleaning, commiserating.
If you purchase, you still do the hello letter, right?
I know.